Good evening. Good evening to everyone. My name is Emily White, and I'm president of the League of Women Voters of Newcastle County. Welcome to you all, and I'm very glad that you came here tonight to learn about the process of amending the United States Constitution. I'd like to thank Widener University Delaware Law School for providing the wonderful courtroom, and I'd like to thank our sponsors as well, Americans for Democratic Action, for Democratic Coalition for Open Government, and Common Cause of Delaware. Making democracy work requires a tremendous amount of determination. In 1920, the women who fought to secure the right to vote for women founded the League of Women Voters to help voters secure and engage with government. 95 years, and the League has worked to empower voters to improve their communities, the state, and our union. The League proudly celebrated 95 years of strengthening our democracy. We worked proudly to pass the National Voter Registration Act, the Clean Air Act, and many other important reforms, and the membership is open now to men as well as women. The League and all our co-sponsors are nonpartisan organizations. The purpose of this forum tonight is to provide an understanding of the issues being addressed in a study about structures of American democracy. Across the nations and across the United States, the League of Women Voters are concerned about the U.S. Supreme Court and its decision with Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission. It was ruled in favor of unlimited corporate spending relative to elections. Many groups and citizens are putting pressure on our Congress now to amend the Constitution. The League of Women Voters does not have a position against the Constitution, therefore it cannot lobby for or against any proposed amendments or a constitutional convention. Tonight we will hear from an expert from all perspectives on this complex issue of amending the U.S. Constitution. Letty Diswood, a member at large for the League of Women Voters and a member of our co-sponsors as well, will introduce Dean Smolla. Letty, thank you.
My name is Letty Diswood. I am a member of the League of Women Voters and also a member of the co-sponsoring organizations. Rod Smolla is Dean and Professor of Law at Widener University Delaware Law School. After graduating from Yale and Duke Law, first in class, he returned home to Chicago, where he began private practice, then moved into academic life, beginning his career as a law professor. He has had a multifaceted career, serving as president of Furman University, dean of two law schools, at Washington and Lee University, and at University of Richmond, before starting at Delaware Law this summer. Smolla is an accomplished teacher and author. His latest book, The Constitution Goes to College, deals with constitutional principles and ideas that have shaped higher education. Throughout his career, Dean Smolla has been active in litigation matters involving constitutional law, civil rights, mass media, advertising, defamation, and privacy law. He has participated as counsel or co-counsel in state and federal courts, and is a frequent advocate, having presented many oral arguments, including some before the U.S. Supreme Court. He has been an advocate for greater bipartisan cooperation in addressing major issues of public policy and for greater civility in public discourse. Welcome. We'll hear from Dean Smolla. We have time.
Thank you. Well, welcome, everybody, to Delaware Law School. I've been asked to begin with a commercial message, and so the commercial message is this. If you're interested in seeing some previews of the cases that are about to be heard in the Supreme Court of the United States this term, We have created a website called the Supreme Court Preview, and it involves a number of law professors here at the Delaware Law School who have done little 5 or 6 minute preview programs on the most interesting cases pending in front of the court. I did a few of those myself, and you can reach that by going to the internet site that is delawarelaw.widener.edu/Supreme Court 2015. And if you didn't get that, I think if you Google it, you will find it somehow. Okay? A lot of you know that for well over a decade, the rage in the world of American culture and mass media has been a thing called UGC. Does anybody know what UGC stands for? Oh, brilliant. Who had the answer to that? All right, user-generated content. That means that you have a business like Facebook or YouTube or Twitter, and you're able to make money by serving folks with that business, but the beauty of it is they supply all the content. And so it's a wonderful business model if you can do it. You get paid by advertisers or subscribers for stuff that other people make, okay? Well, I was inspired by that to create something that I call UGL. Can you intuit what that might be? User-generated law is not bad, not a bad try. You're close. It's user-generated lecture. So the deal is, I'm going to come here, and you think I'm going to do the speaking, but in fact, I'm going to count on you to generate the intellectual content. Now, to do that, we're going to have some role-playing exercises, and you're going to be required to play a number of different roles, principally one role. And I'm going to play many, 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 many different roles. And to help us do this, to help us be psychologically prepared to be able to take on these different personas, I was able to get through TSA recently after coming back from a trip from London. I happen to have a friend who does intellectual property work for J.K. Rowling. And this friend of mine slipped me this liquid I have in this vial here. And in consuming this liquid, not only will I be at an enhanced level able to take on multiple personalities, but you will as well. You've done so well so far. Does anybody know what's in this vial? Oh my goodness, I've never been in front of Ross. So brilliant, exactly. In fact, this is Super Poly Juice Black Label, all right? So for those of you that have not read the Harry Potter books yourselves or read them to your children or your grandchildren, Polyjuice Potion is what Harry and the others will take when they sometimes need to assume the personalities of others to fool them. So I'm going to take this, and then I'll be playing multiple roles, and I'll be helping you play multiple roles. So if you just give me a second here. Okay, Transformicus Supreme Corticus. I am now the President of the United States. I nominate everyone in this room to the position of Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. I am now the entire United States Senate. All 100 senators live through me. I now unanimously confirm all of you. I'm now the Chief Justice of the United States. I need to swear you in on oath or affirmation. So if you would not mind standing up and raising your right hands and repeating after me. I do solemnly swear or affirm that I will faithfully execute the office of Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. I will strive to do impartial justice and will, to the best of my abilities, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. For roughly the next 45 minutes. Your Honors, you may be seated. I will now play the role of your law clerk. You are about to hear oral argument in a Supreme Court case. You will hear the lawyers for one side argue for approximately 15 minutes, and then you'll hear the lawyer for the other side argue for approximately 15 minutes, and then you, the justices, will have the opportunity to debate the matter and to vote on it. Now, as your law clerk, I'm going to brief you on the facts and the issues of the case that you're about to hear, but I will leave it to the lawyers for each side to argue the matter. This is a case that involves, for one of the very, very few times in the history of the country, Article 5 of the Constitution of the United States. Article 5 is one of those random, seldom used, very poorly understood provisions of the Constitution of the United States that has rarely come up in American history. Unlike freedom of speech or freedom of religion, things we all know about and talk about and debate all the time, most Americans have never heard of Article 5. As your law clerk and former law professor, I teach the Constitution for a living, and I can't tell you the content of Article 5 without reading from it. So I'm going to take my copy very quickly and read you the language. It goes like this. The Congress, whenever 2/3 of both houses shall deem it necessary, shall propose amendments to the Constitution, or on the application of the legislatures of 2/3 of the several states, shall call a convention for proposing amendments, which, in either case, shall be valid to all intents and purposes as part of this Constitution, when ratified by the legislatures of 3/4 of the several states, or by conventions in 3/4 thereof, as the one or the other mode of ratification may be proposed by the Congress. That's the sentence. A lot of commas there. Sounds like it was written by Henry James. That sentence has never really been interpreted by the Supreme Court of the United States. Now, it involves two provisions by which we might amend the Constitution of the United States. The first is the only provision that's ever been used in American history. Congress, through a 2/3 vote of both houses, can propose amendments to the Constitution, in which case they are then sent to the various states, and if 3/4 of the states ratify the proposed amendment, it becomes part of the Constitution. Under the current math, how many states are needed to have a constitutional amendment become effective? 38. What? This is the smartest audience. And, you know, when I took constitutional law, it was my understanding there would be no math. But here we go. Now, the other interesting way in which the Constitution may be amended pursuant to Article 5 is through the calling of a convention under the Constitution. And the convention may propose amendments. And notice the number is a little lower. How many states does it take in order to propose an amendment? 2/3. And today that would mean how many states? 34 is the winner. Exactly. Upon the application of 34 states, Article 5 recites, the Constitutional Convention must be convened by the United States Congress. Does anybody know, among the justices, how often in history that convention clause has been invoked under Article 5?
Zero.
It's a trick question. Some of you might have been tempted to say, oh, we know once in Philadelphia, but that was before this Constitution was created. That's the convention that created this Constitution. So never in the history of the country has a constitutional amendment been proposed. Now, as we stand here now, depending on who you ask and how you count the states and what is considered in the total or not in the total, somewhere above 30 states appear to have applied for a constitutional convention to be called on the issue of whether we should have a balanced budget. And there is also gathering momentum by a number of different groups, even the League of Women Voters, we've heard, maybe one of them, to ask for Congress to convene a constitutional convention on a number of other issues. Well, here, Your Honors, is what took place. There reached a point in which the Congress of the United States made the determination that at least 34 states had called for a convention on the issue of whether the federal budget should be a balanced budget. That is required under the constitutions of many, many, many American states, many, many countries worldwide. It's not required under the United States Constitution. And so there has been a movement dating back decades that it should become part of the Constitution. And Congress made the judgment that 34 states had made the application and a convention should be called. Here is then what happened. And here is the dispute over which you will hear oral argument. The first question was, where should the convention be? And in a controversial decision, it was decided it should be in Philadelphia. This was very controversial because some saw this as an invitation to give the convention the same freedom that the delegates who assembled in Independence Hall felt they had when they formed this constitution, a sort of wide-open freedom to do whatever they thought was right. So some people criticized Philadelphia as a choice, but the counter-argument was, if it's good enough for the Pope, it's good enough for the Constitution. What symbolism, what power, what resonance, what a great city to have it in. We've already got the constitutional center there. It makes perfect sense. And so that's what happened. There was then extraordinary chaos, extraordinary confusion over how states were to select the delegates to the Constitutional Convention and how many each state got. Congress had been silent on this point. So they call a convention, but how many tickets are there going to be? Is there going to be a SEPTA lottery? How do we organize this? And so some states sent 25 or 30 delegates. Some states sent 2 or 3 delegates. They arrive, having been selected by their state legislators to come and be members of this convention. And as you might imagine, as this group assembles, there is absolute procedural chaos. Through some kibitzing behind closed doors, through some discussion, through some informal judgment, a chair is selected to at least bring the order of there'll be a chair to the conference. It was decided that the head of the Pennsylvania delegation, as the host state, could at least open it. And of course, immediately there was a fundamental core question about how the convention would go about its business. Your Honors, can you guess what that might have been? The Constitution is silent and the Congress has chosen to be silent over how the votes are organized. And so there are people that say, well, it can't just be by a majority vote of the people here, because some states sent a lot of people, some states sent fewer people, there was no formula anybody gave, it would be the state that sent the most people would get its willpower imposed. Someone said, well, maybe that we should vote sort of in the way we vote for the House of Representatives, that no matter how many people you got, your state got the number of votes roughly that it would have as representatives in the House of Representatives or representatives in the Electoral College. But other states said, no, we don't like that, because then the people in the smaller states will be kicked around. They won't have legitimacy. A constitutional convention is called by states as states, not by the people of the country. And so the states should have a role. So there was debate and there was fussing, and roughly speaking, the big states, California, New York, Texas, Florida, Pennsylvania, they like the idea of votes apportioned by population. And the small states, Vermont, Delaware, Wyoming, Alaska, they like the idea of every state gets one vote or every state gets two votes, period. Someone came up with the ingenious compromise. Why don't we have the convention vote on the same pattern, under the same principles that ultimately emerged from the Philadelphia Convention over 200 years ago? There'll be two different votes cast on every issue. One vote will be by state, and every state will get just one vote. So we won't have two senators, we'll have one state vote. Delaware gets a vote, New York gets a vote, California gets a vote, and you've got to get at least 26 votes for any issue to carry. We'll also have a second vote, and in the second vote, states will cast votes according to their population, according to their representation in the House of Representatives. So a state like California may cast 46 votes. A state like Delaware would cast one vote in that situation. And so it'll be done the same way the House of Representatives is done. This was a compromise, but it was a compromise reflective of the way the United States Congress works, and it had a kind of legitimacy no matter which way you saw the matter. Now, did it mean everybody had to suddenly send that number of people? So if you were Delaware, you had to make sure you only had, you know, one person, and if you were California, you had to quickly make sure you had 45. No, it was a sort of virtual process. The idea was that you could vote within your state delegation any way you wanted, but the voting power would reflect this ratio. So if California had 10 delegates, and they voted 6-4, then California would get 60% to 45 on one side and 4 on the other. You get the idea. The theory was that there'd be this balance. The second, and so people felt good. People felt, we're making progress. This is orderly. Makes some sense. The second question immediately proposed from the floor was this. A motion was made that the business of the convention should be deemed to encompass any issue on any topic relating to governance in the United States, relating to the Constitution. That although the conference had originally been called to consider the balanced budget question, no proposal should be deemed by the conference sitting there as out of order. So one could propose an amendment to reverse the Citizens United decision and have it made illegal for labor unions and corporations to contribute money to the political realm. One could propose an amendment to reverse the Supreme Court's decision on the Second Amendment and allow there to be gun control and not have an individual right to bear arms. One could propose an amendment to overrule Roe v. Wade and allow states to decide for themselves whether they have abortion. One could propose an amendment on any issue, and it would be debated, it would be studied, it would be voted upon, and if it were to pass, a majority of the states voting one vote each, and a majority of the delegates voting in proportion, it would become an amendment to be proposed then to the states. But it couldn't become law unless 3/4 of the states would endorse it. There was great debate within the conference, but a majority of the states casting their one vote each said, we like the idea of being able to pick any topic that anybody proposes and have a vote on it. And interestingly, a majority of the 435 delegates voted for the same freedom. And so suddenly, almost any issue that has been at large in our constitutional tradition was up for grabs as part of the conference. There were proposals voted up, and there were proposals voted down. I'll tell you the amendments that succeeded. Some might be identifiable as part of the agenda of more liberal, progressive elements of American society. Some might be perceived as part of the agenda of more conservative elements of the American society. There were amendments that were embraced by the Tea Party. There were amendments that were embraced by the most liberal branches of the Democratic Party. Through some combination of compromise, of playing it out, of vote trading, of the way that anybody makes decisions, these are the proposals that made it. Some of them were amendments to the main body of the Constitution, the original articles of the Constitution. Some were amendments to amendments, amendments to the Bill of Rights, or amendments to the 14th Amendment, and so on. But there turned out to be quite a basketful, so let me tell you all of the various places the Constitution was amended. To make it easy as your law clerk to remember this, I'll try to kind of go through the Constitution in order. Article 1, which deals with the legislative branch and the powers of Congress, was amended. It was amended in two ways. It was amended substantively by passage of the Balanced Budget Amendment. Now, that passage of the Balanced Budget Amendment did not cleanly require a balanced budget. Following a pattern that existed in some other nations, a balanced budget was required except in times of war. There was a war exception so that you could have deficit spending to finance a war to save the nation. That passed. There was also an interesting procedural change in Article 1. Following a constitutional notion that exists in many American states, some 41 American states. Article 1 was amended to require that no bill proposed to become part of the American law, could have more than one topic, a single topic rule. This exists in many, many states. So if you're going to legislate on the internet, you can't have something in it dealing with defense spending. If you're going to legislate on health care, you can't include something in it connected to immigration law. And the theory is this makes for a more legitimate, transparent, clean legislative process because you don't have the temptation to trade votes. Some cynics covering this on Fox and CNN and MSNBC pointed out that it looked like the delegates themselves had traded some votes, but they were willing to say at least the better view is that should not happen in the future under our constitutional system. Article 2 was amended. That's the article that deals with the powers of the president. It was amended to forbid the President of the United States from sending the armed forces of the United States into military conflict in a foreign nation in the absence of a declaration of war from Congress. Some think that no amendment is required to do that. Some think that's the proper way to interpret the Commander-in-Chief Clause right now, but this convention made it explicit that that was required. Notice a kind of symmetry. You can go into debt if you're at war, but you can't have a loose definition of war. There's got to be a declaration of war. So those seem linked. The convention was on a roll. Article 3 was amended. That's the article that deals with the Supreme Court of the United States. It's a very short article. It was amended to change the provision that gives justices lifetime tenure during good behavior. Instead, a term limit was established of 16 years. Why would the delegates pick 16 years? They thought in terms of presidential generations. The argument against lifetime tenure that was on the floor of the convention was that A justice might serve for 30 years, for 40 years, for 45 years. And that justice might have a critical role in interpreting constitutional law in a manner that was long, long, long past in terms of the constituency that selected the justice, the president that appointed he or she, the Senate that confirmed the justice. And so the notion would be, yes, well, if you get your president elected, typically that president does have substantial power to shape the court. And maybe the next president is stuck with what the last president did from the last party. But we can't be stuck forever. And after two cycles, a 16-year cycle is gone, it's time to force retirement. And so that was passed. Wow. Article 5 was amended. Now this starts to really get deep. This is an Article 5 convention. This is a convention called under Article 5. This amendment was passed. The convention said Article 5 as properly currently understood, but as now to be absolutely clear in the future should always be understood, allows for any convention formed by the application of 3/4 of the states to take up any issue they want. So here the members of this conference were seemingly trying to self-endorse the very runaway freedom they had taken on to themselves by saying, it's always meant that, but just to be sure, that's really what it means now going forward. That ended the amendments to the main body of the Constitution. Now they turned to the Bill of Rights. They started with the First Amendment. They modified the first clauses of the First Amendment, the clauses dealing with religious freedom. Following a pattern that exists in the United States federal statutes and that exists in many state constitutions, but is not current legal doctrine under the Constitution, they passed a religious freedom provision, which reads, kind of lawyerly this one, it reads that if any government, state or federal, state, federal, local, any governmental entity shall pass a law substantially burdening the free exercise of religion, that law shall be unconstitutional unless it is justified by a compelling governmental interest that, and the law is narrowly tailored to effectuate that interest. That awkward phrasing is the way the Religious Freedom Restoration Act at the federal level is currently phrased, and the way the Religious Freedom Restoration Acts of most states are phrased. But that has been taken out of statute now and embedded into the First Amendment. There was also an amendment of the Free Speech Clause. And the amendment of the Free Speech Clause vindicated those that disliked the Citizens United decision. And it provides that the First Amendment shall not be construed to prohibit laws that control contributions and expenditures in political elections by any group or individual. And so the entire body of law that has existed for some 30 years from the United States Supreme Court dealing with the complex area of limitations on what an individual may spend, a wealthy candidate like Donald Trump may spend of his or her own money, or what people may contribute and who may contribute, individuals, corporations, how much, would, if this amendment were passed, be wiped out and legislatures could pass what kinds of restrictions on campaign finance they want. The convention, still on a roll, went to the Second Amendment and made the judgment, as you might imagine, controversial, that decisions over the regulations of guns shall be delegated to the states, and no individual constitutional right to bear arms shall be deemed to exist. And so decisions over gun control at the federal level, at the local level, at the state level, are purely a matter of legislative choice. If Chicago wants to ban guns, it can. If the United States wants to ban guns, it can. If Vermont wants to ban guns, it can. If they want to regulate it, they can. The right to bear arms under the Second Amendment has been eliminated by the conference. Finally, the Due Process Clause, which exists in two places in the Constitution. The Fifth Amendment has a Due Process Clause, and the 14th Amendment has a Due Process Clause. And the Due Process Clause is the font of the various privacy rights that have evolved in the latter part of the 20th century and this century. The conference first addressed the issue of abortion, overruling Roe v. Wade, and saying that the decision over abortion should be left to the states, provided, however, that no state may ban abortion in situations necessary to save the life of the mother. And so that amendment was passed. And finally, perhaps most explosively, given the very recent lineage of this rule, the conference addressed same-sex marriage and said that the question of marriage and who shall be eligible to be married shall be exclusively the province of the several states, giving every state the right to make its own decisions over whether or not to allow same-sex marriage. Well, that ended the convention. What started off as a balanced budget convention became an extraordinary rewriting of many, many parts of the Constitution, with people attracted to some provisions, repulsed by others, but all of them proposed to the states. But not as a big package deal, proposed to the states individually. So states could reject them all, pick the ones they liked, and ratify them all. And of course, it would take 3/4 of the states to make a decision. When these events took place, there were members of the United States Congress who thought that the convention had acted in a manner itself unconstitutional. They took the position that Article 5 gives to the Congress the power to convene the convention. And Congress has the power to convene the convention on a limited issue. Congress may only convene the convention, they argued, if there's an application of the necessary number of states, 34 states, and the application came to them on one issue. So the convention had no freedom to roam at large. The Congress voted to challenge the legality of all the amendments proposed except for the balanced budget amendment. The one amendment passed that was in the original charge of Congress. Congress hired lawyers, and a lawsuit was commenced entitled United States Congress versus United States Constitutional Convention. The lower courts held that they had no power to intervene, that this was a political question to be decided by the political process and not for judges to rule upon. This left, basically, the power with the convention, I suppose, since the convention had proposed these amendments and Congress did not seem able to get a court to block them being sent to the states. That then led to the argument that you are about to hear. You'll hear the lawyer for the United States Congress argue for 15 minutes. You'll hear the lawyer for the convention argue for 15 minutes. And then you can decide the issue. Now, Your Honors, I don't know how many of you have been to see arguments in the Supreme Court of the United States or listened to them on the internet. But you should know, by tradition, as a courtesy to the advocates, the justices give the lawyers 5 or 6 seconds before the first interruption. So rarely does a person not get their name out. And usually you get your name out and you're allowed to at least say who you represent. But then after that, by tradition, The speech is over, and every single bit of the rest of the time is taken by the justices firing questions to the attorneys, often two or three justices at once, so it's hard for the lawyer to know where the questions are coming from. And the lawyer answers and typically does not finish her answer or his answer before the next question comes. And the justices can ask about anything: history, policy, the constitutional text, inconsistency in positions, anything they want. They can ask friendly questions or aggressive questions. But as justices, particularly on your early days on the court, I urge you to err on the side of aggression. Oyez, 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 the Chief Justice, the Associate Justices of the Supreme Court of the United States. All persons having business before this court are admonished to draw nigh, for the court is now in session. God save the United States and this honorable court. Mr. Smolla, you may proceed. Thank you, Your Honor. Chief Justice, and may it please the court, my name is Rodney Smolla, and I represent the Congress of the United States. Your Honors, it's the position of my client, the combined House of Representatives and United States Senate, that the various amendments proposed by this convention, including amendments that would change the very nature of Your Honor's own appointments, forcing many of you immediately off the bench if it is passed and ratified by the states, cannot possibly be constitutional. 34 states petitioned the Congress to deal with one issue: whether the federal government should. Yes, Your Honor. It takes a two-thirds resolution passed by both houses in order to transmit a proposed amendment to the states. And that's happened very, very rarely in our history. There have been 27 amendments, the first 10 part of the Bill of Rights.
But what are your opponents saying would be a mechanism for getting this set of amendments sent to the states if they're contending that you, Congress, have no role? How are they thinking it's going to get sent?
Your Honor, I'm sure that the respondent's lawyer will have her own answer, but my answer is this. The question is not whether Congress plays a formal role once the convention has proposed amendments, because I will concede, Your Honor, that there's nothing in the text of Article 5 that says Congress convenes the convention, the amendments are proposed, the amendments go to the Congress, and Congress then takes them out to the states, and Congress exercises some discretion over which amendments it will send. So I concede that point, Your Honor. But it's our submission, that's not the problem, because if we have standing, if my clients have standing, if the Congress of the United States has a right to litigate this issue, then the Congress is allowed to contest the legality and the constitutionality of what has happened. And since the Congress alone had the initial power to convene the convention, that gives it the institutional interest, the interest in its view of what Article 5 means, that allows it to litigate the question.
So I understand in the past there have been a lot of calls for conventions on many different things.
That's true, Your Honor.
Why didn't Congress choose to aggregate those calls and hold this convention early?
Your Honor, it's our submission that the very fact that Congress did not is an important historical practice that dates back decades in the history of the Republic that proves the substantive point that I am making on behalf of my client. Congress does not treat every application as part of some gross number. So once you've accumulated 34, even though two may be on gun control, one may be on abortion, three may be on the balanced budget, once you add them up and you say, ding, 34, there's suddenly a constitutional convention. Congress has instead historically taken the position, you've got to reach 34 on one issue. And so logically, if you've got to reach 34 on one issue to call the convention's business itself should be limited to 34. And there's another provision in the text itself that we think is critical. When you read the provision of Article 5 that is at issue here, It is fascinatingly all one sentence. The first part of the sentence is clearly a single-shot sentence. The first part of the sentence, which deals with the right of Congress on a two-thirds majority to propose amendments, clearly contemplates Congress will propose an amendment on one issue and send that to the states. Seamlessly, it then goes along and says, or on the application of three-fourths of the states, may have a convention to propose amendments. So there seems to be a linguistic link between the two conceptions.
So historically, what was the call like for the Bill of Rights? Was it a call on the Bill of Rights over a broad spectrum of things, or was it a call where there's 15 or 18 or 20 specific calls?
Remember, Your Honor, that the Bill of Rights was not originated from the convention. There had been a kind of deal struck in which it was understood that Congress would propose those amendments. But the Bill of Rights initiated with Congress, and Congress actually had more than just the 10 that we know of. There were 12 altogether, and eventually 11 of the 12 made it. But we think of the First Amendment as the First Amendment as part of that package. Congress has the absolute right when it's exercising its authority to propose them as it will. And our submission today is states could have picked and choose. States could have decided that the First Amendment they would ratify, the Third Amendment they would not, etc. Congress could have, I assume, proposed 10 amendments at once and called them one big giant amendment with different numbering systems if it chose to do that. But the point is that whatever mechanism is used, it must be, given what the framers clearly had in mind, that conventions were not to roam at large and decide to pick any issue under the sun that suddenly struck the fancy of the delegates and propose amendments based on that.
Did the Bill of Rights not begin with Article 5 clause of that whole effort?
It didn't, Your Honor. I'm sure the respondents will make an argument along those lines. But remember, there was no Article 5.
Was there pressure put on by Article 5 calls on Congress to pass the bill?
There couldn't be an Article 5 call to create the original convention. Are you talking about the current convention or the original one in Philadelphia?
No, the current convention. For the Bill of Rights in history, like there were several Article 5 calls that were.
I'm sure you will hear, Your Honor, that the framers in Philadelphia that created this Constitution took the ball in their own hands, and instead of proposing amendments, rewrote the whole thing. I'm sure you'll hear that. And it's our submission that's irrelevant for a number of reasons. First of all, this court has no authority. This court can't exist except for the Constitution of the United States. This court didn't precede the Constitution. It's a creature of the Constitution. And the oath you take is to uphold this Constitution.
But is Article 5 not part of the Constitution?
Article 5 is, but Article 5 has a very important word, the word this. Article 5 says amendments may be proposed to this Constitution, suggesting that a convention process, just like the congressional proposal process, is a way of tinkering and making adjustments, as we have at a number of important junctures in our history, giving women the right to vote, giving abolishing slavery, so many important amendments that we've made, but the notion was you had a constant.
Counsel, is it your position that if two-thirds of the states agreed to call a convention to amend whatever parts of the Constitution are deemed needed by that convention, that then that would be constitutional,
yes.
But that this is different because it only said balanced budget.
I couldn't have said it better than myself, Your Honor. That's exactly our position.
And further, your contention is that everything outside of the balanced budget amendment is outside of the scope of the call, but the balanced budget amendment itself, which is within the call, is
it's permissible, and we do not challenge the balanced budget amendment, Your Honor. Your Honors, I was in the middle of one final point. I see my time has almost expired. There are two reasons why it must be that the Articles of the Confederation precedent, the Philadelphia precedent, is not binding. I've already given you one, that you, the Supreme Court, are a creature of this Constitution and are bound to interpret it. But secondly, I want to anticipate in advance an argument I'm sure you will hear the respondent make. In some ways, the fact that the framers in Philadelphia did not feel bound by anything, they didn't feel bound by the instructions from their own states, they didn't feel bound by anything the Continental Congress had done.
I don't understand that. You're comparing the Constitutional Convention to an Article 5 convention. Isn't it apples and oranges?
I am. That's exactly what I'm saying, Your Honor. The fact that they ran with the ball doesn't mean that these folks can run with the ball. Because back before this Constitution came into existence, there really was no United States in the way that we know the United States. There was no federal sovereign with any power the way we know it. It was a collection of sovereigns. It was South Carolina and New York and Pennsylvania and Delaware. And those sovereigns came together, they appointed representatives, and they created this brand new creature of federalism. They may have run with the ball. That was between them and their state. If somebody had a grievance, it was with Delaware's delegate, Caesar Rodney. But it wasn't with the Constitution. It couldn't be. It hadn't been created yet. So to the extent that the other side relies on that historic precedence, it's our submission, Your Honor, that's an illegitimate argument. Thank you, Your Honor.
In order to become law, this has to go back to the states and be approved by 76 out of the 99 legislative bodies in the country. It needs to be ratified by
it has to be ratified by 34 states, Your Honor.
No, 38 states.
Or 38, excuse me, you're right. You're right.
So if that's the case, if 76 of these legislative bodies need to approve what comes out of this convention, then why are we even having this discussion? Because it's impossible for what you're saying to go back to the states and get ratified by 76 legislative bodies out of 100.
Well, Your Honor, we don't know. I mean, there have been amendments that have been passed. We don't know what combinations of state would pass these. And Congress's beef here is not with the substance of any proposal. This was a bipartisan vote in the Congress, an overwhelming vote. It was not about whether they like gun control or don't like gun control, not about whether they like abortion or don't like abortion. It was that the energy, the constitutional crisis, the chaos, the effort that would be that the country would be thrown into is inappropriate under our constitutional system. We limit the occasion in which proposals are made for the solemn question of whether they will amend the Constitution, which are matters of great moment and great debate within state legislatures. We limit those to those occasions in which it has been set up through the appropriate mechanisms. And it's my client's position on behalf of the Congress that it exercises a gatekeeping function as a guardian of Article 5 to be sure we don't suddenly start launching on these giant nationwide plebiscites on this rule or that rule.
Why was an injunction filed earlier than when the Congress expanded in scope?
Your Honor, the
looked at this a long time ago and said that the process for Congress...
The lawsuit, Your Honor, the lawsuit was brought as soon as the convention concluded its business. And my client took the view. A lot of what the convention did came at the last minute. People weren't sure what was going to happen. There were a lot of votes that came in a flurry at the end. Not all the business of the convention was open to the public. This is the Philadelphia convention was not open to the public. So, Your Honor, I don't think we can be excused. The moment that convention adjourned, Congress initiated this matter.
How would you answer the question that your claim makes unparalleled what Article 5 makes parallel? You concede that two-thirds of Congress can propose any amendment they find suitable, yet you deny that a convention proposed by two-thirds of the state can propose any amendment it
finds. Your Honor, I do see my time's expired. Will the Justice allow me to answer the question?
And I take issue with that.
I'd rather you do than I do, Your Honor.
I think if obviously, if two-thirds of Congress voted for 14 or 15 different issues, total of two-thirds voting in favor of something, but not all voting in favor of the same thing, then there wouldn't have been a convention.
That's our position, Your Honor, that there is, in fact, parallelism, that Congress only submits amendments on a single issue or on two or three issues on which there is uniformity there, and it therefore has the right to say that same notion is the way the states have to operate. The states don't have the freedom, if I can go back to the first question I was asked, to accumulate, and if they don't have the freedom to accumulate, their representatives can't, after the fact, engage in accumulation. Thank you, Your Honor.
Another question?
Yes, Your Honor.
Can I ask why your clients didn't pass a law which defined this before the convention ever got started?
Your Honor, there was a proposal decades ago advanced by Senator Sam Ervin of North Carolina to purport to enact federal legislation that would provide in advance for how constitutional conventions would be ordered and what they would be allowed to do or not do. He was the champion of that rule. He was a constitutional scholar. Of course, I know the justices remember him from the Watergate hearings. When he died, when he left Congress, there was no other advocate for it, and the matter was never brought up again. And I think, Your Honor, I know my time has expired. If you'll allow me 15 seconds more to complete the answer. It's our submission, as this court has held a number of times dealing with structural issues. It talked about this when President Truman seized the steel mills. It's talked about it a number of different times. History can be a gloss on the meaning of the Constitution. When you have generations and generations that interpret a certain part of the Constitution in a certain way, even though it may not be literally written that way, that informs us as the collective understanding of the people as to what it should mean. And so we think it's very, very important that Congress never did this because they didn't think they needed to. Because they took it as obvious that if a convention were convened, it could not be a runaway convention, which is what this was. Thank you, Your Honor. Chief Justice, and may it please the court, my name is Rodney Allen Paul Smolla, and I represent the Constitutional Convention of the United States. Your Honors, the text of the Constitution ought to govern the outcome of this dispute. History gives us no clear answer. Precedent gives us no clear answer. But the text gives us an answer. And the text is eloquent in its silence. Congress knew how to be specific. Excuse me, the framers knew how to be specific when they deemed it important to be specific. The framers left things open to the democratic process and to the rough and tumble of politics when they felt that was important. Think about one of the most fundamental omissions in the Constitution. We know there's one president. We know there's one vice president. We know how many senators there are. We know how many House of Representatives members there are. How do we know how many Supreme Court justices? Article 3 is silent. It doesn't say there should be 9. It doesn't specify any number. In the early days, there were 7. Congress has chosen the number 9. Congress couldn't conceivably change it, as Franklin Roosevelt tried to do. The Constitution was never intended to solve every issue. And the framers, who were themselves revolutionaries, I submit to you, Your Honors, would be on my side and my client's side. They would say these people who met in Philadelphia in 2015 did the same thing we did in Philadelphia in 1787. They would say once they were there, they were Burkean representatives. That is to say, under the philosophy of Edmund Burke, who many of those members of Congress read and embraced, once you are elected to be a representative, you bring your own conscience, you bring your own reason to bear. You are not slavishly responsible to anyone.
But are we talking about a completely different kind of call here? 1787 was a call to scrap the Articles of Confederation and create something new out of whole cloth.
Not really. They were charged with amending the Articles. Isn't this right, counsel? And to amend the articles that the states should have been required to approve unanimously, but the convention simply scrapped that without any authorization.
And it's our submission, Your Honor, that contrary to what the petitioner has said, when he came up with this hocus-pocus, almost theological argument, that what the convention did didn't matter because you're a creature of a new constitution. That's like when I was at a Jesuit school, the Jesuits would ask, could God make a rock so heavy he couldn't lift it? It's a trick question, because no matter how you answer it, you're wrong. If God couldn't make a rock so heavy he couldn't lift it, he can't be God, because God could make a rock that would be any size, right? But if God can't bind himself to make a rock so heavy he couldn't lift it, he can't be God either, because he should be able to make anything, including a rock so heavy even he can't lift it. Well, it's a goofy question. It's a silly question. It's angels dancing on the heads of pins. Here's what matters. Your job is to try to decide what you believe Article 5 means. And what better evidence of what Article 5 means could there possibly be than the behavior of those who wrote Article 5? So if they came to Philadelphia...
Haven't we previously said that the proper interpretation of Article 5 is a political question, and therefore the political branches, namely Congress, are left to decide its meaning?
Your Honor, we think it is a political question, but in the way this court has defined political question. When this court has said a matter is a political question, it means it does not think the court has any power to rule at all. And it has done that on rare occasions, but on a number of occasions. The lower courts in this case did that. They said, we don't want any part of this. This is not for the judicial branch. This is a matter for the hard-fought battles within the convention. And we think the lower courts correctly, absolutely correctly, both interpreted the political question doctrine and appropriately interpreted the text. Because here's my, I think, most important answer. And it was alluded to earlier, and I don't think that the petitioner had a very cogent response. The framers have thought ahead about this. In some ways, it doesn't matter what a convention approves or disapproves. It doesn't matter what Congress submits or doesn't submit. You've got to get the ratification of 3/4 of the states. That was the check and balance. They didn't deal with whether there can be a limited call or an unlimited call.
For clarification on that, so what you're saying essentially is that no matter what this convention, because there's a lot of hypotheticals who the delegates are going to be,
right?
How are they chosen, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But what it doesn't seem hypothetical at all that the convention does not have the power to change the Constitution if the Constitution itself is valid. Those words have meaning.
The convention can, or the convention can't
propose.
Change it. They can only propose.
So there's no danger of changing the Constitution at a convention.
There is no danger. It can't be done.
So anything that goes out, just for clarification, anything that goes out of the convention would have to be approved by 75% of our state governments.
Exactly.
And if the convention created multiple amendments, would those each be considered separately, or would those be considered as one big...
It's my submission on behalf of my client, Your Honor, the convention. But that would be up to the convention. But in some ways, that is a diffused issue. They took the pressure off because they didn't take this as a take it or leave it, vote for them all or not vote for them all. They proposed them seriatim. And so it's possible we might go 50 years and none of these would be enacted. It's possible there'd be a rush to enact a balanced budget amendment and the others would meander and there'd be a period of time and you might see something happen or not happen. That's actually, the other side painted that as somehow terrible. What could be better? Think of all the middle school and high school debates that you're going to have over these various amendments. Think of all the essay contests. Think of the robust discussions on the internet and on television. This is a revitalization of the democracy. The fact is there are people that think you ought to be able to control guns that feel marginalized by the Supreme Court's decision. There are people that are against Roe v. Wade that feel marginalized by the Supreme Court's decision. There are people that don't like us going to wars too easily. Your Honor, they could.
Did they in this case?
They did not, Your Honor. But that doesn't solve the legal issue of whether there's any compulsion that they do so. And once the convention is assembled, it's our position, It becomes a constitutional entity unto itself. It has certain powers that inure to it, certain inherent powers.
Are you saying that the applications that come from the state, you add them up, you get 34, even though those applications mandate that the delegates at the convention stick to that topic, once the convention convenes, they're no longer legally bound to stick to that mandate?
It's not, we don't think the record in this case is quite so precise as the state's mandating that the convention stick to that topic. They called it on the topic. Most of the resolutions of the states were silent on what the framers are bound to or not bound to. Even within the world of balanced budgets, there are all sorts of different versions of balanced budgets among the states and among different countries. There are states where it's almost meaningless.
But this convention that you're talking about here, I remember reading them, and all 34 of them said that they had to stick to that topic, that they mandated that, and they couldn't go off topic.
I must have missed that paragraph, Your Honor. But
that was actually a mandate. So the
answer is that once the states have called the convention, the states themselves lose superintendence of the convention. They get back their sovereignty on the question of ratification. And so it's not like they've surrendered their power. They've surrendered their agenda power. They've surrendered their proposal power. It may be precisely why there's never been a convention called before now.
So on that point, if the states did have this mandate and they passed 34 applications on one issue, and then a convention, for whatever reason, they took on the sovereign power of their own and decided to go off topic, it seems like those same states would not be as willing to ratify that.
And Your Honor, our position is that that has been well known for 200 years, and the very swirl of debate over whether to propose a balanced budget amendment is filled with groups, all sorts of groups, leagues of women voters, internet groups, Tea Party groups, ultra-liberal groups, who said maybe we should back the idea of a convention because we cannot be certain that the convention would go off topic. So people knew that. And so our view is it was a risk assumed by the states, a risk assumed that when they started these folks together, things may move. And Your Honor, think about how difficult it would be if you were to say they had to stay on topic. But since legislation and ideas may start in one direction, what if someone were to come up with a different way to deal with balanced budgets, like a line item veto, or a supermajority in order to get it? And you start to say, how far afield do you go? It's got to be balanced except for Social Security.
Why wasn't the convention run with a standard set of rules like the legislature would be, or accepted conventions?
Your Honor, it came into existence with no pre-existing document to govern it.
I mean, that would be really unstandard. That would be not like any other constitutional convention that had been held for a state. I'm just confused about why that person wasn't used.
Congress did not attempt to set any rules. It presumably would have been the only body. My client didn't exist until Congress called the convention. My client was scattered among all these different states, in a sense.
The calling of the convention, why weren't those rules adopted?
Once the convention was called, they did, as a first order of business, elect a chair, enact their own version of the Great Compromise, a sort of virtual mimicking of the Senate and the House of Representatives, make the decision as to what the rules should be, as to what was in order or not in order.
They also decide what public information would be able to go out so the public wasn't.
They adopted rules on their own governance, including whether sessions would be open and closed. They were mostly open. They at times went into executive session. They didn't have Robert's rules. They didn't have it. They had what they had, and they decided to create their own set of rules. I see my time has expired, but the court may have additional questions.
Does your client use the words a convention for proposing amendments to support your position?
Yes, Your Honor.
A convention.
A convention, that's what we were.
Proposing amendments, plural.
Amendments, plural. We think that text supports the position that that a convention may propose amendments, which is literally what we've done.
Of all the amendments that were proposed during this that you listed, what is your opinion on which ones will actually be ratified by 38 of the 50 states?
Your Honor, I'm an old enough lawyer to know that my opinion cuts very little value with most courts. I have no idea. What I do know is that even amendments that have a huge amount of momentum behind them and a powerful social and cultural current behind them often fail. The Equal Rights Amendment is probably the most significant and salient example. So even at a time in which the rights of women and equality for women was at its apex in terms of its momentum in American society, that amendment was never able to gain the necessary 38 states. So we think that is an argument in our favor, Your Honor.
Yes, so would it follow, in your opinion, that any amendment that did make it through that check and balance you referred to would be something of the significance of women's right to vote, something that universally is important, something that's a divisive issue?
In fairness, Your Honor, maybe I'd say yes, but prohibition.
That's about the details of the process, and I think those are two very different questions.
And Your Honor, history may tell us that generally that has been the case. That is to say, generally the major amendments to the Constitution have dealt with fundamental issues, but there have been some random and obscure ones. Prohibition on a single issue of social policy involving drinking, even in the Bill of Rights. There's the forgotten Third Amendment, never interpreted once in the history of this court, prohibiting the quartering of troops in peacetime. Most people have no idea what that even means. The Seventh Amendment, which guarantees the right to a jury trial in a federal court if at least $20 is in controversy, has been deemed so unimportant that it doesn't apply to the states. And so it's hard for me to say, Your Honor, absolutely. One might hope that most would have the grandeur of the 13th Amendment, abolishing slavery, or the creating of women's suffrage, but we know from our history it's hard to say. And in this case, who am I to judge? That is to say, Your Honor, to some people, overruling Citizens United is as profound as a balanced budget. To others, it's a triviality, a little cul-de-sac in First Amendment law. Our view is, let the states decide. That's the genius of our federal system. No harm has been done allowing it to go forward. Yes, Your Honor.
Your Honor, how does this affect, I think it's Amendment 18, where the government can provide for the good of the people, for the good of the masses, or for the common good?
You may be referring to the General Welfare Clause.
Yeah, for the common good.
And this court has held the General Welfare Clause is essentially a political question. That what is or is not in the general welfare is not something a judge can determine. And we think this is another one of those issues. Not everything needs to be decided by this court. Not everything needs to be decided by federal judges. And you have a kind of conflict of interest because you'd be deciding to unseat yourselves or at least pave the way for possibly unseating yourselves.
Do you have a recent citation for the position that you just put out?
What's the position, Your Honor? You know, I don't have it off the top of my head, but the Supreme Court, this court very recently refused an opinion by Justice Scalia
isn't the discussion omitting an important qualifying phrase that precedes general welfare, that is, Congress is given the power to tax and spend to provide for the common defense of general welfare, is that not?
That's right, and
probably tax and spend to provide for them.
And Your Honor, the most significant decision by this court recently under the Taxing and Spending Clause was the decision written by Chief Justice Roberts upholding the Affordable Care Act on the theory that even though the Commerce Clause acted as a restraint on the powers of Congress, the Taxing and Spending Clause did not. But it's our submission, really none of that matters. Because what matters...
You mentioned Citizens United just a minute ago.
I did, Your Honor.
And then you also said... We think that should get to the states.
That constitutional amendment to overrule it, of course, must be up to the states. Article 5 provides for that. my point was simply that you can't make judgments about whether it's important stuff or unimportant stuff. It depends on the eyes of the beholder.
Like state legislation versus...
Oh, no, of course not. Citizens United is the law of the land. It will remain the law of the land unless reversed by this court or reversed by a constitutional amendment. Right. Your Honor, I see my time has expired, but I see the court's still active.
is there any precedent for the Supreme Court ruling that any other efforts for an amendment have been a political question?
There have been very few, but there is one, Your Honor. The Supreme Court held in the 1920s that the question of how long an amendment remained alive, whether it had to be ratified within a specified period of time, or whether it could remain in front of the states indefinitely, was a political question. That the court would not opine on that issue or rule on that issue, that it would leave that to the superintendents of Congress. And indeed, there is precedent. The 27th Amendment, dealing with the obscure requirement that members of Congress cannot vote themselves raises that become effective during the term of Congress in which the vote takes place. The idea being you shouldn't be able to vote yourself a raise when you control the Treasury. That amendment was originally proposed during the epoch of the Bill of Rights. It wasn't ratified until the last decade, and it has been deemed part of the Constitution.
Your Honor, did you mention the 17th Amendment just now?
No, the 27th.
Oh, sorry. The 17th Amendment, is it true that that came about because the states called for a convention for...
There are historians who will say that sometimes Congress proposes to avoid and to take an end run around states calling for a convention out of fear, perhaps, that once the convention is convened, you can't control it. And so Congress will say, we'll get ahead of this curve and we'll propose an amendment.
Maybe they will be embarrassed more than they will run out of control. They don't want
doesn't matter why. If Congress proposes the amendment, the deal is done. If the states call for it,
so
it's a convention.
As a tactic, is what you're saying.
I would say this. It's a part of the political process, and another reason why this should be a political question. Yes, Your Honor.
I just want to make sure that the questions can go for open to anybody, not any kind of question. We have a few more minutes left. Can we do that?
Your Honor, I see my time has expired. Now you are the justices of the Supreme Court of the United States. You're in conference. Some of you have been in the Supreme Court, have seen the conference room. It's a beautiful, beautiful meeting room. You can go there on a public tour, but you can't go there when the justices are in the conference room. No one is allowed, not their clerks, not assistants. No one is allowed in the conference room when the nine justices are there. And so the tradition is every justice gets to speak. They start with the most junior justice and go around the table until they get to the chief justice, and then every justice gets to vote. So the floor is open for a couple of minutes for comment on how you would vote, and we'll keep the matter simple. Would you say only the balanced budget provision can go to the states, or would you say they can all go to the states? We're not going to try to control what the convention has done. People have comments or questions to share with your fellow justices, this would be the time.
Do we need the roving mic?
I'll repeat the question for everyone.
I just have a question. There was a timeline on the ERA.
There have been timelines on some amendments.
Who imposed that?
Congress.
Right.
But it was extended, wasn't it?
And it was extended once, that's right.
Yeah, it was extended once.
And the Supreme Court refused to intervene in the extension. So amendments can say that. They can say it's got to be ratified within 10 years or something like that. This one, you know. But you all should be talking to each other, because I'm not allowed in the room.
Okay.
I think we should be looking at what we really mean by precluding all these things outside of the balance budget. We're not saying that, maybe we should be saying, hey, it's not that these things can't happen forever, ever. No, I think what we should be saying is we're precluding them from happening in this particular convention. I think that understanding of preclude is really important.
I think as a court, our best avenue would be to say that this issue isn't really yet right. There's not a real conflict yet that we have to decide. It would only matter that we would have to come into it only if 38 states actually ratified
some proposed amendment other than the balanced budget amendment. At that point, there would be a kind of constitutional crisis because Congress might choose to accept it or Congress might choose not to accept it. If Congress chose not to accept it, then there might be a lawsuit where we would have to decide. Until that time, I don't think we should be thrusting ourselves into the political process. I think we should just leave it to the people.
So can we just clarify that? What's the question is just simply...
It's not yet a case of Congress.
Can the House consider just one amendment?
Congress is seeking a declaratory judgment.
Yeah.
That the only provisions properly before the states are the balanced budget provision.
Yeah, I think that the case that was laid out is, I think, crystal clear. I mean, the states should have the power to call for a convention for one specific purpose, and if it's a balanced budget, I mean, I don't personally support that, but the definition of democracy is that if a majority, you know, of people and the country want something, then that should be the rule. So 34 states, that's a lot of state governments, want to have a convention just to discuss having a balanced budget. It's not even proposing it. I mean, it's not even ratifying, it's just proposing it. Then that's literally the definition of democracy. It's obvious that the states should have the power to call a limited convention. And all the other stuff that they wanted to throw in there should be nullified, because if they want to have a convention to propose those amendments on that topic, they can get 34 states to do it. But in this case, they didn't do that. 34 states got the momentum, so I think that's pretty clear, actually.
Krista, go ahead.
My fear is, everyone, is that if a constitutional convention is so hard to follow through without really making problems worse, and since the states can be considered as a sovereignty, the thing is, and there has been different sections of the countries that have thought about amending themselves from the United States, Texas,
mm-hmm.
California, even right here in Delmarva Peninsula, we've considered just make it a whole state.
Yeah, but I think there's a big turn in history from that.
Yeah.
You know, from
succeeding.
So
that's not what we're planning.
I know, but I'm just saying, if a constitutional commitment is so hard to follow through and to institute and establish without really making things worse or losing ourselves,
I mean,
it opens up for the states to break away from.
No, all we're talking about.
That's not the question.
No, yeah. I think the precedent here is, as you mentioned, the go ahead. I'm sorry. Did I interrupt? Okay. The precedent here is that 34 states were challenged to bring forth this particular topic of the balanced budget by the populace.
Right.
And the populace gave Congress the power to take on this particular subject, period.
They gave the convention the power to take it on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Because at this point, that was the only avenue that the citizenry had.
Right.
To do what they wanted.
Peggy's next.
I think that the point I mentioned earlier in Article 5 is the most compelling argument on this situation. It says a convention for proposing amendments. So I don't think we can argue logically that this makes more sense or that makes more sense. It appears to me that it's in the language of Article 5. I don't see it as controversial. A convention for proposing amendments.
Well, I think sometimes a certain topic might require a couple different amendments for that, but they could still be seen as, you know, for the same topic. So you might need to pass one.
In other words, legally you could write in the application it needs to be on this topic. But I think it's been interpreted that, okay, so you're going to have this convention about a balanced budget amendment, and out of it can come 8 potential amendments on that topic, and then the states vote on them. That's been like one interpretation.
Does that actually happen? It just occurs to me, we've had a fantastic interaction about these theoretical issues,
and about where the power of the people resides and, you know, how it can be constrained. But we have to remember that the legislatures that are sending these delegates and making these rules have already been captured by special interests. Right, so we're not really talking about the people deciding. We're talking about the apparatus that's been captured by special interests, sending their people to decide
on
behalf
of the
people.
You're going to have to build the political power to make sure they don't
matter. So 3 minutes before the German time. So there is one constitutional rule that I think has been violated, and that is all public events should end on time. And so, given that higher law, how many of you, if you feel inclined to cast a vote, would be inclined to say it is permissible for all of these amendments to be considered by the states? You rule against the Congress and in favor of the convention. Raise your hand now. And how many of you would vote that only the balanced budget amendment can be heard by the states? So by a vote of about 6-3, this court has ruled in favor of the Congress. Now, your time as Supreme Court justices has expired. Your time as citizens is not. If you experience the sensation of being a Supreme Court justice for longer than 4 hours, you may want to consult a physician. Thanks a lot. See you later.